Peace.
Peace.
This is Joshua Law, Mr. PhD. You're just now entering the cipher called Real2reel360.
Uh-huh.
K-Wise.
Peace, God.
Bring that beat in, kid.
Indeed.
Peace.
Yeah. What's going on, party people? Welcome to the Real2reel360 show. Let's get it in. Knowledge and wisdom, so you can understand. Real2reel360 shows in full command. We're changing the game for how it all was taught. From bondage to freedom to an independent thought. Yo, the show is here to bring about a change for real. To lighten everyone so we all know the deal. 360 degrees is a fact. We created the show to give our love back to our communities so we can know what's going on and give them the support from knowledge to born. So if you're ready to learn, then it's time to go. Sit back and relax and enjoy your show. Peace.
Peace and blessings to Allah's mighty 5% nation of God's thirst to all the human families of the planet Earth. We bid your love, peace, and happiness. High salute. I am DJ K-Wise Allah. Welcome to the Real2reel360. Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, it is deeply an honor and a pleasure for our tonight's episode. We gave you a little bit of who we was going to bring on yesterday, and he's here. But without further ado, we're going to bring on my co-host with the most, my brother in God, so we can get this on, because it's going to be very insightful and powerful and dynamic. Let's go.
Am I the meanest?
Sure enough.
Am I the baddest mofo low down around this time?
Sure enough.
But who am I?
Joshua Law.
Who am I?
Joshua Law.
I can't hear you.
Joshua Law, Mr. PhD.
Peace to all our followers, likers, and subscribers. Thank y'all for tuning in to Real2reel360. We are in the building today.
Yes.
The gentleman that we have is a singer, songwriter, indie entrepreneur, video distributor, radio personality, 80s icon. This is a legend right here.
Yes, living legend.
He is the one living legend, living icon. And there's so many superlatives to speak about this man, but we're going to bring him in. The one and only, Mr. Jay King of Club Nouveau. Let's go. How you doing today, sir?
I'm good. How you doing, sir?
Man, I'm great, man. It's an honor and a privilege, man. It's an honor and a privilege to have you on the show today. And trust me, it's like... You go through a lot of individuals, you speak to a lot of individuals, but when you have a man that has been from the grassroots of pulling himself up in the music business, pulling himself up in the video movie business and doing the things that you have done, it's truly an honor and a privilege to have you on. But if you don't mind, could you just go ahead and introduce yourself to all our followers, likers, and subscribers?
My name is Jay King, and I'm happy to be here, honored to be here, and thankful that the breath in my lungs allow me to be here today.
I tell you, it's an honor. Want to start out early in your career. When you started out doing music, I think you were like 19 years old, 19, 20 years old.
Yep.
Started out initially in hip hop and rap. Before you transitioned over into R&B. What was that experience like? And then also too, you started out as an indie artist and want to tap into the indie part, but in the beginning you was an indie artist with a rap group called Frost. How did that come about?
Well, I was promoting concerts in Alaska. I was in Alaska because I was in the Air Force. And I was in the Air Force for an actual year from start to finish. I went in on March 31st. I was out on March 31st of the preceding year. But so I stayed in Alaska and I started promoting concerts, just, you know, locally doing things there in Alaska. And I was a dancer, so I was popping and breakdancing and stuff, and I had a group there. And so, you know, I'm in the arts. And because I'm in the arts, you know, Alaska, there's only 300,000 people live in Anchorage. 600,000 live in the state of Alaska. The whole state of Alaska, 600,000 people. 300,000 in Anchorage. Of the 300,000 that live in Anchorage, 5.2% are Black, or about 15,000. So there's a pretty healthy Black community in Anchorage, Alaska. And arts were happening. Anchorage was a pretty hip place because you had a lot of people from a lot of different parts of the country living in Anchorage, Alaska. So you had guys from New York, you have people from Chicago, you have people from California, you have people from different states. And believe it or not, a lot of music came through Alaska before it hit the lower 48. I see Karen White just entered the building.
Karen White. How you doing? And you know, it's funny because I've been trying to get Miss Karen White for the longest on the show.
So we'll link that up. I don't know what Karen did because I was just with Karen a few months ago in Africa and she looked great. But I just saw Karen the other day. She looked like she lost 20 years. I'm like, how'd she become a teenager all over again? What are you doing?
All right.
Now, Mr. King, working, and what did you see about the independent circuit that you felt like it would be easier for you to navigate in the beginning?
Nothing. I didn't see anything that made me think I would be able to navigate. I didn't know independent from major. I didn't know any of that stuff. It was just by happenstance. So I bring Confunction to Anchorage, Alaska. Mm-hmm. And I'm a big fan because I grew up in Vallejo, and I used to pretend that I was Michael Cooper. So my love for Confunction is deep. And so I bring them to Anchorage, Alaska.
Right.
And I form a friendship with Michael Cooper. And so because as you said, I was in a rap group. I had a rap group called Frost, and we had this song, F-R-O-S-T, We Rock the House So Viciously, Deliciously, Nutritiously. It was that kind of rap, right?
Right.
So Michael Cooper brings us down to Vallejo, to California, and we work out a demo. And his managers, Tony Sobel, Ron Kreitzman, they hear the demo and they say, hey, we're going to take you to PolyGram and we're going to get you an album deal. So, of course, we're excited. We're in Anchorage, Alaska, and we're getting ready to get this album deal. But PolyGram offers us a 12-inch deal. And because we are new to this, we don't care if it's a 12-inch or an album. But our managers say, no, we want an album or nothing. So PolyGram says nothing. And we end up with nothing. So they formed this independent label using a company called Bacola Records. Bacola Records was known on the West Coast for Egyptian Lover, Egypt, Rodney O, and Joe Cooley, Everlasting Bass. And so they were doing those types of records. And these guys, they formed a label called Triangle Records with a guy named Randy Rand. And Randy Rand is who I connected with. And they put out this record that we had called The Battle Beat. And that was the first production, me, Denzel Foster, Thomas McElroy, that's the first record we do together. And The Battle Beat, we think of they put the record out and it goes double wood. Would have been a hit if it would have been good, and nothing happened. So I'm disappointed. And I talked to Randy Rand one day, and I tell him that I want to do my own label. And he said, yeah, you can. So I go to Ron and Tony, who's our managers, and they literally cuss me out and tell me why I can't do independent label, that I don't know what I'm talking about, I don't know what I'm doing, and they really talk crazy to me. And I'm embarrassed, and I hang the phone up, but I'm so mad when I hang the phone up that I call them back. And can I cuss on this show?
Sure.
Oh, sure, so I say, I'm gonna beat your ass, you little faggot, you little bitch. So, you know, I'm really mad. And, you know, you can't tell me that I can't make a label. I can do whatever the fuck I want to do. So I'm saying that stuff. And I hang up the phone on them. Mm-hmm. And then I call them back. And Ron says, Jay, I'm glad that you're calling back. And I'm going to get Tony on so you can apologize. And he got Tony on. And I said, you motherfuckers are fired. And I hung the phone. And then I connected with Randy Rand. And I and then I let him hear the song called Rumors. And Randy Rand and I were in a car together. We were in Burbank. I flew to McCullough Records to meet Don McMillan. And he heard Rumors. And in the middle of the street, he literally put his brakes on and said, it's a hit. It's a hit. Rush it, rush it, rush it. And I literally went home the next week. I mustered all the money I could get. Recorded Rumors, and that's how it started. But if I to tell you that I could differentiate major from independent, or that I had this plan or this idea, or that I knew what I was doing, and that, you know, that I was just this genius, I would have to put my bullshitter alert on, because I'd be lying to you. And you know, God is, this is where what we call the vibration, the universe, God, whatever, that's where that thing becomes the protector of you. And God at that point became the protector of me, because if there was anybody who made every mistake that would ensure that you wouldn't have a hit record, I was that guy.
Now, you touched on Rumors. Now, Rumors was a song that Timex Social Club came out with, that you written. How did that meeting with yourself and Timex Social Club come about?
There was a guy named Daryl Thompson. Daryl Thompson lived in Anchorage. Uh-huh. So Daryl, but his family was in Oakland. When I did the Battle Beat record and I was working with Confunction, they knew I was in their camp as a writer. Daryl Thompson said, I have a brother named Marcus who has this song called Rumors. They need help with it. And I told them, you would be the guy to help them. And so he brought me the song, and that's how I met those guys. So it was Daryl Thompson who would eventually do the artwork to the album cover, the iconic cover that's Rumors. Daryl Thompson did that artwork. So Daryl Thompson was how I met him.
Okay, now, was there any given time that you was going to be a part of Timex, or you just was going to be the singer-songwriter for them?
I was never going to be a singer. I was just a songwriter and a producer, and a guy with an independent label that just started it from happenstance. Because I didn't like the way the business felt to me when I tried to be a rapper.
Now, with being independent and having an independent label, what was it like for you to have a top charting Billboard single that you have written yourself on your independent label? Because at that time, it was unheard of to really have an indie record label.
Let me clear it up first. I did not write the record. Okay. The Timex Social Club brought the record written. What I did was I fixed the record. Okay. I made the record. I made the idea into a record with production behind it. Mm-hmm. And I have to be honest with you, they did not like what I did to it. They thought that I messed their song up, that I didn't make it better. But that was because they had been listening to it as a demo for so long that they married themselves to the demo versus marrying themselves to a finished production. So so that part, it was a lot of work. It was hard work. As a matter of fact, the work was so hard that when they say, how they say you get excited about hearing your record on the radio and having success, mm-hmm. I never had that feeling. Because the work was so hard and Herculean that I didn't get the opportunity to feel that. Today, with the new single, I feel it. Today, I'm excited. Today, I get all giddy when I hear about the record because I'm in it in a different way. I'm a lot more measured and mature. I understand the process of the game. I have mm-hmm. patience, and I appreciate the fact that hit records aren't easy to come by. So, and especially when you're my age, you know, right. I'm not a kid. I'm 62 years old.
Right.
But when you still have music in you and you can connect with the public from a vibration standpoint, it shows you how blessed, fortunate and lucky you are to be able to still connect, you know, in a business that's changing. And this business iterates every 2 to 3 years. So in order for you to be a great artist, you have to be functioning. You have to be iterating every 2 to 3 years, changing with the industry, which is in and of itself a difficult task.
Now, we wanted to touch in on that single right quick with Timex Social Club, and then we want to jump into a little bit of Club Nouveau. So right now, ladies and gentlemen, this is Rumors by Timex Social Club. Let's go.
My best friend said,
Man.
Classic.
Not only is it classic, it's so nostalgic when you think about coming up during that period in time and how music was and how the business of music was. Now, during the period in time that you started out in music, how has it changed or evolved for you as well being in the music business and seeing how it went from, like you said, cassette tapes, vinyls, to now to streaming?
Well, first let me acknowledge a few people. I see Ralph Johnson from Earth, Wind, and Fire in the building.
Yes, Mr. Earth, Wind, and Fire is in the building.
I see Renee Escovedo from the great Escovedo family. He'll be playing with me tomorrow in the building. I see Joe Levy, who's also going to be playing with me tomorrow in the building, and a whole bunch of my friends. Just wanted to make sure that that the artists that are here, that they recognize, and I recognize them.
Oh, definitely.
So Ms. the music.
Frances
the
Wright?
Music, yeah, Frances Wright. She's our art director for the show tomorrow. She's going to make sure the venue is beautiful. So they're legally in order. I see everybody. So thank you guys. Thank you guys for it. Okay. So, you know, just like music iterates, so too does music business. Mm-hmm. So I came in a business where major labels owned and controlled masters. And so I was an anomaly for that era, because here I was with this independent record label, independent song, battling against the majors for national recognition at a time when people said independent labels, especially R&B records, at that time only hip hop records were independent and making a mark. If you were a R&B record, like my record was, you had to find a region, make the record a hit in a region, and then the major would come, take the record from you, sign the group, and the major would take it national. But I didn't do that. I started off nationally, and people said I was crazy for doing it, and that it wouldn't work, and I didn't have any money. You know, so there are a lot of factors here that you have to talk about in order to talk about the music business yesterday versus today. Mm-hmm. Radio was different. Back then, black men and women owned the majority of black radio.
Right.
Back then, you couldn't own more than 7 radio and TV stations combined. So there were no conglomerates. And so you could make a relationship with radio programmers and owners of radio stations, and you know, at KDKS in Louisiana, you know, or KYKO in Little Rock, Arkansas, you know, so Shreveport, Louisiana, Little Rock, Arkansas, Dothan, Alabama, these little bitty towns have 20, 30, 40,000 watt radio stations and a lot of black folk. So you could build a record from a different transistor than you can today. So that was one of the great values of the music business in the 80s. So I think I tapped into something that most artists didn't. And that is, you could build a relationship with radio and you didn't need anybody else, just you and radio, and you could break your own record. But it costs so much money to manufacture. That's why Mercola became important, because with Mercola, you could manufacture 1,100 units or 1,500 square vintage. You didn't have to have tens of thousands, right? So you could build some scratch. And that's what Egyptian Lover and Unknown DJ and Rod Neo and the LA Dream Team and World Class Wrecking Crew, that's what they did. So I just followed their I followed their lead because they were in front of me. I was just the first one to have an R&B record, number one. And we really merged R&B and hip hop. And I always tell people, we were the first of the new school and the last of the old school as it related to technology and production. You know, we did everything with drum machines and keyboards. There were no guitars and bass players. There was just, and percussions. It was just the 808, the Linn, and the SB1200, the emulator to the DX7, the Juno 60, the 106, and the Mirage. And that is what we made the Club Nouveau and Timex Show Social Club records with. Those things, the only time we ever used any instrument that was a string instrument was on Situation Number 9, when the guitar said, ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-king, ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-king-king. Otherwise, everything was done in a box. So we were the beginning of that. So from that standpoint, that's how, so we were at the precipice of the cutting edge of technology and music. Today, we're at the precipice of the cutting edge of music and technology as it relates to how we listen to music, how we distribute music, and how to get music out to the masses. And that's the power of digital. It literally chopped the knees of the major labels by putting the power in the hands of creative people. Mm-hmm. So now the guy 62 can put a record out, you know, hire a indie radio guy. Now it's going to cost money. It's going to cost tens of thousands of dollars to get your record promoted on the radio, but it cost tens of thousands of dollars back then. So From that standpoint, it's the same. It's just the apparatus has changed, but why wouldn't it? The world changes. So I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't going to be an old man. And talk about what the music business used to be and how it was different, because that's what old people do. And that's what old people did when I made Rumors, and they were telling me why Rumors sucked and why it wasn't a good record and how it sounded like it was made in the garage and how the singer couldn't sing and how he was out of key and how the snare drum was too loud and it sounded like a rap record. Because it sounded like he was rapping instead of singing. All the stuff that old people say when change is upon them, I didn't want to be that. So I don't ever want to be that. I think when I start to be that, that's when I know it's time for me to get out of the game.
Right. Now, when you talk about distribution and mm-hmm. getting distribution deals, how important as a independent record label is to invest in getting a distribution deal and also with your marketing and promotion of different records that are on your label?
Well, first of all, what do you mean invest in getting a distribution deal? You can get a distribution deal through DiscoKid. You can get you can go distribute through TuneCore, through CD Baby, or, you know, so if there's or Empire. There is no deal that you have to go pay for anymore, you know. So that's over with. If you don't have money, mm-hmm. what kind of innovation do you have? Right. How creative are you? You know. So technology has empowered you, mm-hmm. but how much of your power are you trying to harness? And how responsible do you want to be to the harnessing of that power? Mm-hmm. Because those are questions you have to ask yourself, because that's what's going to determine how far you go and how you go that far. What are you doing? And how much, you know, and so I have enough money to pay for radio. So guess what I did? I paid for radio.
Right.
But even in paying for radio, because I'm from the 1980s, I'm going to get some pushback from people that will say, The Club Nouveau record is a good record, but I don't want to play a group from the 80s. Mm-hmm. And I got to be able to take that to the head and keep going. So you can't have girl skin out here. You got to have alligator skin out in these streets. Right. You know, you got to be willing to pay for your and fight for your position and then do the work. Artists are some of the most selfish people I know that want to do the most minimal of work, and they expect everybody else to do the work for them because they're the talent. And that's not the world we live in. You want it to happen? Get up off your lazy ass and do the work. Make it happen. I think it's a time. I think everybody out here can make money, can be rich. I believe there's enough money in the game for everybody to get some.
Right. Now, shout out to DJ T Money, one of the hottest young DJs out nowadays. Hit him with the kick. He's definitely in the building. But with the Club Nouveau record, Baby, Let's Dance.
That's not Club Nouveau.
Is that a collaboration?
That's not Club Nouveau. That's Jay King. So that's why you guys asked that question. Yeah, so let me say this. So I do bossa nova music as Jay King.
Okay.
So Baby Let's Dance tonight is a totally different genre of music than what I do with Club Nouveau, which is more urban pop music.
Okay.
And that's the beauty again of being in the world. In the world, you can do whatever you want to do. You don't get limited. The only person that's limiting you is you and your inability to see past what other people think about you. So Baby Let's Dance tonight is a collaboration between Derek DOA Allen and myself. Derek started producing records for me a few years back, about 7 years ago. I was working on demos for my second solo album, Hell and Sun. And I didn't have a lot of time. And I went to Derek one day and I said, listen, I have skeletons of ideas. I want to send them to you if you like them. And you want to produce with me, let me know. I sent him the songs. He said yes. He sent me some ideas from the skeletons I sent him. And we started working together and we've been working together ever since. So that's how all the Jay King stuff come along. So Jay King has a totally different path with the Soulful Bossa Nova album than Club Nouveau with the It's All Right single.
Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you go ahead and introduce Baby Let's Dance.
All right. So this is from the album Soulful Bossa Nova. I'll be performing that song tomorrow along with a bunch of others for the Sack Pack show with myself, Joe Levy, Lucky Witherspoon, Sean Rayford right here in Sacramento, California. The show is sold out. We're happy about it. This is Baby Let's Dance tonight, written and produced by Jay King and Derek DOA Allen.
Let's go.
Right, and it's time to
Let's go. Oh man, we need to put that up on the radio station, Jay. That right there is that smooth groove, man. That smooth groove. Now, Mr. King, what made you get into movies, videos, and stuff like that? Because you was already doing your thing in music. What was the transition for you with the movie?
So with movies, there were these brothers, Paul Goldsby and Kennedy Goldsby. They're black. They're black guys. And there was a guy named Clyde. God, what's Clyde's last name? I'm going to tell you Clyde's last name. Clyde Jones. Clyde Jones saw me at Roscoe's one day and said, hey, man, I know these brothers. They're trying to make a movie, Jay. They don't have the money, and they really need help. They have Terrence Howard. Terrence Howard was a nobody at this time. He said that they have this new guy named Terrence Howard, who's a really good actor, and they have Glenn Plummer. And then they're gonna lose this movie because they ran out of money. And so I was living in the Bay Area. I just happened to be in LA. And I said, I'm leaving today. And I gotta go back to the Bay. I can come back in a couple of days. So a few days later, I come back, I watch the movie, I like what they're doing. I ask them how much money they need. They tell me. And I said, I'm going to give it to you. So the guy, Paul Goldsby, kind of laughs and he says, well, I'm going to give you the money. I got to fly back home, but I'm going to give you the money. And so he says, we need the money tomorrow. I said, I know. Give me your bank account and put the money up. He said, we don't have a contract. I said, I'm not worried about that. Nigga, you got my money. So if you got my money, you know, I'm gonna get my money back. If we can't make a deal, I'm gonna get my money back. Don't worry about that. You say you gotta have his money by tomorrow, right? They say, yeah. So the next day I send them the money and they continue to make the movie. And I developed a relationship with Paul and Kennedy Goldsby. And I just love the fact that this is 96. So the black men are making movies. It's just kind of cool to me at this point anyway. And then I get to participate I got in the movie business like that and just helped these guys and helped them start their movie career. It wasn't some dynamic. It's funny, a lot of things that happened in my life aren't some dynamic story, you know, like, oh, let me tell you what happened. It was just, it's basic shit. Because a lot of life is really basic. We look for these, you know, these find the rainbow moments. And shit, the rainbow is you. You alive. You know, you have aspirations. You have ideas. That's the rainbow. It ain't, but it's not. You know, so it wasn't anything extraordinary or nothing like that.
Now, Mr. King, you wear many hats when it comes down to the entertainment business.
Yeah.
You're a singer, songwriter, producer, movies, managers. Mm-hmm. How do you, and also too, I keep forgetting to say radio personality, because you have your own radio station. And how do you have this much time to do all these different things within a 24-hour process? And shout out to all those who are watching on YouTube, Twitter, Twitch, and Facebook. Appreciate you. My light-skinned sister Trinicia's in here. Thank you very much for tuning in. But how do you
know? Do you know how many hours there are in a year?
Mm-hmm.
Do you? Are you familiar with how many hours there are?
Yes, sir.
There are 8,760.
Right.
And a lot of y'all be fucking off time. So,
that's true.
Yeah,
that's true.
And I don't have a lot of time to fuck off. I got to do everything I want to do. I want to be it all. I want it all. I want it before I get out of here, because if you live to be 80 years old, you only live in 29,200 days. If you live to be 80, by the time you take away 8 hours a day for sleeping and 8 hours a day for working, mm-hmm. you have 9,733 days for living. Mm-hmm. And that's if you live to be 80. And out of those 9,733 days, you have to ask yourself, how many of them was I young and vibrant? Mm-hmm. How many of them did I pursue everything that was inside of me? How many of them did I fuck off? How many of them was I mad? How many of them did I waste? And I promise you, when you start taking inventory, you're going to find out that you've been fucking off a lot of time. And you're going to say, moving forward, I have no time to fuck off. And you're going to do it all. So I wake up every morning to do it all, whatever all of it is on that day. But I do know this. I will not live in Groundhog Day. One day won't look like the next. They'll always be different, because I'm always trying to be alive in the moment before this whole thing comes to an end. Because this thing that we're encapsulated in, this bodysuit, is going to come to an end.
Right.
I see my dad every Sunday. He's 84. I'm watching his meat suit, you know, start to come to an end. And so I love on him every day, recognizing that I'm gonna be him one day.
That's a great analogy on that, because there is a lot of times that we do sit around and we mess off the days and seconds and minutes of every hour when we could be putting different energies to it. So yeah. What would be the message that you give to young artists or young producers that's trying to come up into the music industry today?
Appreciate the fact that God put something in you that made you a creative force, because he don't put it in everybody. Everybody don't get to be expressive like that, but he picked you. Respect it. Respect the fact that that there's a responsibility that comes with it. And then be humble. You know, you ain't shit without the vibration. And be helpful. Be a giver.
Right.
Always be open to people. My mama said, if what you do make you who you are, then you ain't shit. So don't let the thing that you do be the determining factor of who you are as a presentation.
I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
Mr. King, going back into the days of the 80s sound.
Yeah.
I recall my older brother being a musician. We all come from a musical family. My brother was a drummer. They changed the drum scene to the electric drums, like you talked about, the rolling drum system, man. That was one of the most famous instruments used back then as far as the rolling, the drum, you know, the electric drum.
The 808, rolling drum, drum pad.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. When that came out, that really changed the game and dynamics of music in the R&B world and hip hop world. So were you one of the very first ones to utilize that to the max, as we say?
No, I think that's where we would, you know, you got to remember that Full Force was already doing that with the Roxanne records. Mm-hmm. I Wonder If I Take You Home, you know, the Lisa Lisa records. So Full Force was to the East Coast what we were to the West Coast.
Okay.
So what's interesting is how is what the human being does. We always are looking for the first guy to do it like there was the first guy. Mm-hmm. That was the first guy recognized doing it, but other people were doing shit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's just who gets the recognition, you know. I just think that we were doing what other people were doing. Thomas Dolby used drum machines with Blinded Me with Science.
Blinded Me with Science.
The ABC band used it with How to Be a Millionaire. Mm-hmm. When you listen to Tears for Fear, and you listen to Why You Treat Me So Bad, you know I'm biting, because if you listen to Shout, what does Shout say? Doom, doom, kaka, doom, 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 ka, doom, doom, kaka, doom. Ah, shout, shout, let it all out.
Absolutely.
Boom, boom, ba, 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 boom, boom, ba. What is Why You Treat Me So Bad? Doom, doom, kaka, doom, 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 kaka, doom. You treat the same thing. So we all, you know, it's how you do it. It's what you're taking and how you switch it around. If you hear listen to Happy Feelings and you listen to That's the Way of the World, it's the same song. Mm-hmm. It's just how you do it. Nobody's doing, there's nothing new under this sun.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
The human being is interesting to me.
It definitely is. It's amazing how when you take this journey and the time that you have been in the music business and you still have the same wherewithal and you still inspired every day to make music.
Yeah. When you stop being inspired, you should stop. When it's not an honest emotion coming out of you, you should stop, because now not only are you cheating the music, cheating yourself, but you're cheating the audience. So don't cheat people. You know, if you have integrity, have enough integrity to say, you know what, it ain't in me no more. It's right. Still in me. You know, and I got to be honest. I don't know if I'll do it another 5 or 6 years, but for the time that I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna do it with honesty and with respect for the craft.
And that right there speaks price, because you know you see a lot of people, they come into the business today and they're going tomorrow, and they're, I guess, what you would call chase the check. But okay. It seems
it
seems that today, that when you're doing music, you still love it, you still love the business, and that's where you put out this great music.
I think these kids love it. I think these kids love it too. I think I think Anderson .Paak loved the music. I think Allegra loved the music. I think Giveon loved the music. I think Yeba loved the music. You know, I think Lucky Day loves the music. But I also think they recognize the business, and the music makes a lot of money in business, and so they should get the check.
Right.
And we should get the check. We should respect the fact that with music comes a check, but the check isn't the driver,
right,
of the creativity. The check is part of the process of the creativity. You're so creative, you're so good that, listen, I was with Karen White in South Africa. Mm-hmm. And when Karen White is in South Africa, she's a superstar. I mean, superstar to the degree that if she's just in a fast food restaurant and out in the middle of nowhere, South Africa, somebody's going to say, "It's Cannon. It's Cannon White. It is. It's hot. It's Cannon." And then people are going to converge on it. I know because I was there. Mm-hmm. Cannon White commands a different kind of check in South Africa than she does in the United States. By a lot. She earned that. So she don't do it for the money, because if you're out there with Karen, you recognize that she recognizes the power of her music in another country and the love of the country for her. So she gives a lot. And she should get paid for that. So I don't tell artists you don't have to be a starving artist in order to respect the fact that you're a musician. You know, that's what good business people do. Make sure that there is a check at the end of the day.
Right.
But they don't let the check be the driver of why the artist created.
Yeah. Well, we definitely gonna get into the next two songs for sure, because we're running short on time, but we wanna make sure we play and do our due diligence. What can you tell us about All Your Love? What was the manufacturing process about that?
Okay, so All Your Love is also from the Soulful Bossa Nova album. Mm-hmm. That single is gonna come out in May or June. I just shot the video a few weeks ago, so they're editing it now. I'm looking forward to it. It's one of my favorite songs. What's interesting about this record is I did this song 2 years ago. In radio, when we went to radio, they said this record is too jazzy for R&B record radio. Jazz radio said it's too R&B for jazz radio. But now, since this kid October London has came out,
mm-hmm,
and flip radio on its ear, now they're saying, hey, this record works at radio. So we're releasing it in June. So this record was 2 years before October London, 2.5 years, and now it's going to come out.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you're getting a taste full of it right here. This is All Your Love by Mr. Jay King. Let's get it.
Break it to me, sugar. Like it nice and slow. When I grab over you, yeah, make you ripple. Taste your love all night long. Ecstasy when you move. It's my touch. As you give me more and more of all your love, all night long.
I've been giving you good loving. Will we be getting on? All your love, all your love, all night long, all night long. Give me that, give me that good love, good love. I'm waiting on your baby. When you're coming home, I got something waiting for you. We gon' start in the living room. I wanna get your love, baby. Is it alright? Keep giving me ecstasy when you're born. It's my touch. You know you want. Give it to you, baby. As you give me more and more of all your love, all night long, I'll be giving you good loving. Will we be getting on? All your love, all night long, give me that, give me that good love, good love. Come on, baby.
Definitely smooth, suave. You can call it all that and more. All your love, Mr. Jay King, ladies and gentlemen. And wow, like I said, that's already up on the radio station now. But we're going to talk about It's All Right. Let's talk about It's All Right. And that's, now I'm going to let everybody know, listen, when you hear It's All Right, it's damn sure all right.
Let's go.
Can talk about Mr. Can you just give us a little snippet about It's All Right before we go into it?
Well, you know, this is the first single in a series of four singles that we're releasing over the next 12 to 16 months for Club Nouveau, because we haven't had new music out in a while, and not music that we've supported to really any real degree. I want to make four top 10 records in a row, because I want to make Club Nouveau current in today's market. And so it requires investing and hit songs. So me and Derek Allen were just writing a lot of different stuff, trying to find the right singles to release. This is the first. Right now we're working on single number two. And, once this record starts to die down, we'll drop another record right on top of it. Club Nouveau Without Touring. You know, we're going to be Nashville June 1st. I believe we're in May 3rd through 6th. We're on the Old School Cruise. May 17 and 18, we're in the Dominican Republic. May 25th, we're in Portland. June 1st, we're in Nashville. July 12th, we're in Vallejo. July 13th, we're in Fresno. July 27th, we're in Phoenix. August 3rd, we're in Raleigh, North Carolina. August 17th, we're in Vacaville. And August 24th, San Jose. And we have more dates coming. So we're just going to work, promote this record, and promote the single, It's All Right, which is the first single that we're releasing from an album.
You going to be in?
Yeah, we're going to be in Winston-Salem. August 3rd, Winston-Salem.
August 3rd. Wow. Right there in the backyard. Yes, sir. All right. Well, we're gonna jump right into the single. And if you don't mind, could you segue into that and introduce it to the whole world right now?
All right. So this is the new Club Nouveau single, It's All Right, from the upcoming album that we're working on right now. Hope you enjoy it. Let us know what you think about it. Go to YouTube and type in Club Nouveau, It's All Right, and leave a comment if you dig the video. Club Nouveau, It's All Right.
Let's go.
How should you express it when you love someone? Especially if you're broken and you need some love. Yeah.
Should you just walk away and live in love and not worry? Or should you try to hold on and build your love until it's strong? Cause you feel like you're at home.
If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, I'm gonna love you anyway. It's alright. And if you decide that the pain's strong and it's too hard to keep holding on, my love's gonna be too long. It's alright, yeah. How can you suppress it when you need someone? Especially if that person is a special one. If you know she's a special one,
then your heart wants to stay. Cause love, it don't just walk away. But it's so hard, so thankless. Cause love is always just a test. I'm gonna do what I think is best.
If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, I'm gonna love on you anyway. It's alright. And if you decide that the pain's wrong and it's too hard to keep holding on, my love is gonna be too long. It's alright. If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, cause I'm gonna love on you anyway. It's alright. If you decide that the pain's strong and it's too hard to keep holding on, my love is gonna be to the bone. It's alright, yeah. It's alright.
Yes, sir. It's all
yo,
right.
Hold on 1 second. Hey, K, run that back, man.
Oh, we got to.
Run that back. Run that single back, man.
Run check that back. Now, you said it. Go to YouTube, check it out, look up the video, make your comments. It all should be thumbs up. Right here. Grown folk music, y'all. This is what we do.
How should you express it when you love someone? Especially if you're broken and you need some love. Yeah.
Should you just walk away and live in love and not worry? Or should you try to hold on and build your love until it's strong? Cause you feel like you're at home.
If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, I'm gonna love you on the end way. It's alright. And if you decide that the pain's strong and it's too hard to keep holding on, my love's gonna be too long. It's alright, yeah. How can you suppress it when you need someone?
especially if that person is a special one. If you know she's a special one,
and your heart wants to stay, 'cause love, it don't just walk away. But it's so hard, so stay blessed. 'Cause love is always just a test. I'm gonna do what I think is best.
If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, I'm gonna love on you anyway. It's alright. If you decide the pain's right, and it's too hard to be holding on, my love is holding to the bone. It's alright. If you decide that you're gonna stay, if you decide just to walk away, 'cause I'm gonna love on you anyway. It's alright. If you decide that the pain is strong, and it's too hard to keep holding on, my love is gonna hit you to the bone. It's alright, yeah. It's alright.
Yes, and
man, that song is fire. That song is fire. That song is fire.
Thank you, sir.
You talking, man? Summer hit. That's gonna ring out. That song right there is gonna definitely ring out.
I'm playing it tonight. I'm playing it tonight.
Right.
Yeah, that song, I'm playing it tonight when I go live. Absolutely. Let it be known.
Mr. King, I want to thank you for coming on, because we're reaching at the end of the show, and it was an honor and a privilege to have you come on Real to Real 360. I want to thank you so much. Want to give you opportunity to let people know that how they can book you for shows, where they can see you at on shows. Well, you already gave some of the list, but I ain't hear no Maryland in that, the DC in there. So
listen, it's early. They'll come, you know. And I mean, you know, the music business is a business. So it's about butts and seats. So if somebody thinks you can put butts in seats, they're going to find you, especially in the music business as it's changing right now. You know, a lot of the older acts are starting to get too old now. You know, they're about to phase out. You know, you got Frankie Beverly, who is retiring this year. You know, Ronald Isley is 80-something years old. You know, there's only so long these guys can last. So acts like me and Karen White, who puts on a dynamic show, you know, that, you know, we'll be everywhere we can be, you know. And I think, you know, in a lot of the groups from the 90s, they're coming up. So, but when you get a new record, it puts you in a totally different ballpark. It puts you in a different conversation, puts you in a different space, puts you in a different game, mm-hmm. where people have to pay you based on the dollar today versus the dollar yesterday when you first started. So, you know, I'm pushing Dub. That's what I call Karen. I call her the Dub. Mm-hmm. I'm pushing the Dub to do new music because she's got some great songs, and to, you know, because, and to push herself out there and get in the new business, because Dub looks great. She still sounds great. She's got a lot of energy. And there are a handful of us that exist that can continue to push our generation higher. Mm-hmm. I hope you guys get. Yeah. If you guys need to get linked up with Dub, let me know and I'll connect you guys. You can reach us at clubnouveau.me. Club Nouveau, NOUVEAU. .me, clubnouveau.me. You can also reach me at jayking.me. You can reach me at bclubnouveau@gmail.com if you want to holler at me. Where you also can reach me at official Club Nouveau on Instagram and the Club Nouveau on X. So that's it.
Definitely. Well, I'm definitely going to be in touch with you to get Miss Karen White because I think we had a schedule one time and then something happened. I don't know, but got to get her on the show because she is a phenomenal singer. Man, her shows is remarkable, and it'd be an honor and a privilege to have her on Real3reel360. Well, Big Bro, you know what time it is, man.
Sir. All right, everybody. We appreciate everybody tuning in to the Real to Real 360. We want to thank our special guest, Mr. Jay King, for blessing us with his presence and his true knowledge and wisdom of the industry and how it is and how it goes. And we wish Club Nouveau for the more and greater successful coming around and around. Let's make it hot, everybody. Make it go viral. And also, let's support the boss. Nope. All right? Let's make that happen. Let's go out support and do what we do. Mr. King, you know, you don't have a home away from home. You got a home right here on Real to Real 360. So if there's anything that we can do for y'all at any given time, please don't hesitate to call on us, and we'll answer the call for you any given Sunday.
Thank you so much.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be out of here. It's the weekend. It's wet outside for most people like it is right now for me. So y'all be careful out there in them streets and avoid anything and all accidents as possible. Be safe. On behalf of my co-host with the most, this is DJ K Wise, that's Josh Chanel, Allah, Mr. PhD. We say peace to Allah's mighty Father, Saint Nation, the gods and nurse. We out of here like last year. Peace.
Peace.
Yo, ladies and gentlemen, we starting to come to the end of the show. Right now, I want to take the time out and thank our guests for coming on. Also, too, we want to make sure that y'all listening and subscribing and tell a friend and tell a friend and keep sharing, because we're going to keep bringing y'all the real content. You know what I mean? So, DJ K-Wise, my brother, check us up out of here, son.
True indeed. Peace. True indeed. I want to give a big shout-out to the nation of gods and nurses, to all the human families on the planet Earth. I say peace. But to our subscribers, those who continue to watch and listen to the show, each and every time we come on, I give a big shout-out. Love, peace, and happiness to you.
The peace of man, woman, and child of the you and I verse. It's time for us to disperse. We bring the best, not the worst. We thank you once again for tuning in to the real 360. Bring a friend to hit that like and subscribe so we continue to grow, to bring more knowledge and wisdom to you upon our show. You make it possible for us to do what we do. Now it's time I end it just the way I bring.